Hey everybody! So a little over half a year ago, I saw this awesome video posted by YouTube user RC Testflight on his 1 kilowatt LED flashlight. Now this thing supposedly clocks in at 90,000 lumens, which makes it the brightest flashlight in the entire world. But I think you know where I'm going with this. In the name of science, of course, I would like to beat that record, so I hope you enjoy this video. So my flashlight design is actually going to be quite a bit different than RC Testflight's. So let me show you this here. So I have a white flashlight and a green flashlight. So it turns out, green light is actually quite a bit brighter than white light. Green light at 555 nanometers comes in at about 683 lumens a watt, where ideal white light only comes in around 250. So now you're thinking I'm going to use green LEDs, right? Well, wrong, actually. So it turns out green LEDs are actually very inefficient relative to other LEDs. On a typical green LED, your power conversion efficiency is only like 15%, which is well worse than the other ones. So I'm going to use something a bit different to produce my green light. My solution is to take some of this molecule and blast it with bunches of 445 nanometer light coming from cheap, powerful, and efficient blue laser diodes. So if you do the calculation, you find that the efficiency going from driver to laser to fluorescein gives you about 25% power conversion. And that's compared to 15% from green LEDs, so this is quite a bit more efficient. And now I don't have any fluorescein on hand, but luckily the synthesis is straightforward. So I'm going to use a Friedel-Crafts acylation of a phthalic anhydride with resorcinol, which should give me high yield of fluorescein in the end. So let's start the synthesis. It's always a good day when I get to break into my acid collection, but I know how much hot sulfuric acid on the skin sucks, so that's why I've decided to gear up. I've ground up my resorcinol and phthalic anhydride so I can begin the reaction. Now I'm not going to make that much, but a little of this stuff goes a long way, so even if I get a gram out of this, that'll be very good. I've got my sand bath heated to just under 200 C, so now I can add my chemicals here and start the reaction. My reaction is completed, and it appears to have been successful. That really strong red color there suggests a very concentrated fluorescein. So I'll let it cool down for a little bit, and then I'll extract it. Looks good so far. This is the product dissolved in acetone. I'm going to let this dry out so I can collect the crude product, and then I'm going to wash it with pentane water and brine. So yeah, that'll be a good way to purify it. To show you how potent this stuff is, I'm going to dip the end of my thermometer in this water. There's just a little bit of fluorescein on the end here. It does not take much to make the water glow really brightly. Yeah, you can see it glowing there. That's crazy. And most of it's still back on the thermometer there. Wow. The excitation and emission properties of fluorescein are very pH dependent. So this vial has a pH of about 11, this one has a pH of about 7, and this one has a pH of about 3. So I'm going to take the end of this thermometer, which just has a little bit of fluorescein on it, and dip it in all these. So we can see the emission here. So here's the basic one. Now I'll do the neutral one. Now the acidic one. As you can tell, the more basic it is, the brighter the emission is. Now it's harder to tell here, but the color actually does change depending on pH. It's just more slight. But definitely this one glows brighter, so I'll be using a basic solution when it comes to my flashlight. I decided to go with ethanol for the solvent system because when compared to water, the energy gap between the ground state and excited states of fluorescein is actually decreased, which causes the fluorescent emission to be redshifted a little bit to actually right about the peak of human visibility. In fact, right here I have two vials. The one on the left is fluorescein in water, and the one on the right is fluorescein in ethanol. So under normal lighting, you can barely tell the difference between the two. But when you hit them with the laser, you notice that the one on the left is slightly bluer than the one on the right. And because it's slightly bluer, it's also slightly dimmer to the human eye. So obviously I want to use the one on the right here. Figuring out the amount of dye that I need for this flashlight is one of the trickier parts about this build. Because too little dye, and the molecules will saturate, and I won't get nearly as good power conversion. And too much dye will cause the molecules to quench their own fluorescence. So I need to find a happy medium here. Here's a rough idea of what the molecular energy diagram of fluorescein looks like. So you start by hitting it with a blue photon, which excites an electron to a higher excited state, and that quickly relaxes down to the lowest excited state by vibrational relaxation. And then from there, the electron falls back down to the ground state, emitting the green photon that we know and love. But the vibrational relaxation time is much, much shorter than the fluorescence emission time. So for the sake of the math, we can just pretend like this is only two levels here. So now in order to find the saturation point, I need to come up with a function that describes the population of excited molecules. Now it's hard to just write this function from scratch, so I had to construct a differential equation that takes into account the laser pumping rates as well as the fluorescence decay rate. So once I came up with that equation, I simply hit it with the methods of solving differential equations. And this one is a separable equation, so it's not super hard to solve. And then in the end, you find out that at steady state, you have about 1.84 times 10 to the 12th molecule sitting in the excited state, which is only about 1 nanogram. So that shows that saturation won't be an issue for this flashlight. And also, there won't be any population inversion in the molecules, so this dye will not be lasing and making coherent light. And then, of course, I gotta show my approximations and assumptions. So this assumes that the fluorescein doesn't fall into some metastable triplet quantum state after it gets excited, as well as there's no stimulated emission happening in the cavity. In order to let the blue light from the laser diodes into the dye cavity while reflecting all the green light that's produced so it gets sent out as output, I'm going to use this sorcery right here. So these are dichroic mirrors. They selectively reflect certain wavelengths of light while transmitting others. And as you can see with this white flashlight here, those mirrors are splitting up the white light into different colors. These are really cool. Here are a couple dye pumping cells that I built from those dichros, as well as some regular first service mirrors. And then I'm holding it all together with some Lexan. So watch, let me show you how it works. So this blue laser here can shoot right through that dichro. You can see it pass straight through the cell. And now when I put this fluorescein through it, which you can already see the green glow, when I stick it in here, you can't see any green light coming through there. So when I take the blue laser and hit it, you see not really any green light is making it through that mirror. But a lot of it's coming through the top, and that's where the flashlight output's going to be. So yeah, this should work out pretty well. This is what I settled on for my dye pumping cell. So I currently have a syringe tip in there so I can load it with some dye. So on this side I have some dichroic mirrors, as well as right here. And then on the bottom are some first service mirrors, just regular mirrors. Then on the back I also have a regular mirror that's facing upwards. Then on the top I have a glass slide which keeps the dye in there and lets the output out. So, unfortunately, this because the cell is so small, I'm going to get heat issues if I run this thing for more than a few seconds. So I may have to put a little pump on there to pump the dye through this cell. My other cell had some leakage issues, so I had to make a new one from scratch. But this time I mitered the edges of the Lexan together in order to get a better seal. And I think this will work pretty well. Then also I added an extra syringe tip to act as a vent for when I'm filling it up with dye. Because last time I found it was pretty difficult with the vent I had installed. Then also I put a reflector on it to capture some of that light and somewhat focus it. So yeah, hopefully this works. I've decided to use my laser bazooka as my source for blue light. And I've already begun tearing it down as you can see here. And also I added some convex lenses on the end of those knife edging arrays. That way I can focus the output from the diodes directly onto that dye cell. So I've ran into an issue here. That noise you hear is boiling ethanol. I think my beam is too concentrated inside of the cell, and it's flash boiling the ethanol in there. And it turns out fluorescein does not fluoresce very well in the gas phase, so that's killing all my light production. That's why I'm not getting nearly as much light as I'd like. So I'm going to try diffusing the beam a little bit, maybe even add some water to the mix so it's harder to boil. So we'll try that, see what happens. I put some beam diffusers in the beam path there, but there's still that boiling issue. You can see that little fountain of boiling ethanol there. So yeah, that's a definite issue. So I'm going to try switching the solvent system to water and see what happens. Even with water inside of that dye pumping cell, I'm still getting poor conversion of light. And even a little bit of boiling. So I guess it's back to the drawing board for me. First I need to figure out a way to homogenize the output of the blue laser diode banks better. That way the light coming from these banks distributes itself evenly across the faces of the cell. Then also I need to do a little bit of reading on the quenching mechanisms of a fluorescein fluorescence. So yeah, hopefully I can figure this thing out. I'll give you all updates as I progress on this project. Thanks for watching!